Griff Jenkins spoke with Congressman Paul on the campaign trail.
Congressman, you have quite a head of steam here coming. You're rising in the polls, and looks like Mitt Romney's slipping. What's happening here?
Well, it looks like our message is getting out, and it's a great state. They believe in limited government and the issues I've been talking about, so we're very optimistic about the way things are going. And, I mean, we have a ways to go to really catch them. But I tell you what, if we just get close to them, it's going to be a real big news story.
Why are you getting closer? I mean, you've said on the campaign stump that you've doing the same message you've been doing, but it's starting to click. Why?
I think the country and the world has changed. Certainly the financial situation has changed worldwide, domestically as well as international. And, of course, that was my big issue for many, many years. That's what motivated me to get involved in politics in the 70s, warning about a financial bubble and warning about the financial system and the monetary system. And it's come about. So we talked about the housing bubble before it burst. So now we have the credibility on economics, but we also have credibility on the foreign policy, too, because, you know, the foreign policy, what we fought for the past 10 years, contributed $4 trillion worth of debt. That means money that was spent overseas on these wars is taken away from the people. And that's why we're having trouble paying the bills for medical care in this country. And I think it's all coming together. And, of course, the young people certainly are enthusiastic about that, those viewpoints.
You mentioned foreign policy. Some of your fellow candidates, Rick Santorum, says you're dangerous.
Yeah.
What would President Paul reassure voters that may be drawn to your fiscal message and your constitutional message, but questions your foreign policy? What do you make of what Santorum is saying, and how do you reassure voters?
I sort of chuckle because I can't see how a strict constitutionalist should be dangerous, and somebody who puts on high priority national defense, because there's so few things that we're supposed to do at the national level. One is national defense. So my viewpoint is that what we do overseas undermines our national defense, and we have too many conservatives that say that if you just spend more money overseas, you're going to get more defense. But I don't believe that. You get more militarism. You want more defense by having a different type of foreign policy. They accept those that reasoning domestically. You know, if the Department of Education isn't doing well, conservatives don't say, well, this doubled. Well, sometimes they do double the size of the Department of Education. But that's not a conservative viewpoint. You know, just pumping more money domestically. And that's the way I'm consistent in that. I look at that internationally, just sending over more foreign aid and invade another country that hasn't done any harm to us, that doesn't give us more defense, and people are catching on to this.
I know you've been asked this, but if you become president, what is the first thing you would do foreign policy-wise? I mean, I think people want to know, I know you've said you'd end wars, but, you know, once you're president, it changes. What would be the first thing you'd do?
Well, that's one area where the president does have an authority, because he's the commander-in-chief, so you don't have to go looking for another war. And you don't have to intimidate people. You don't have to say, we're going to put a lot of sanctions on you and disrupt trade around the world. So, but you can like, say, well, you know, our national security doesn't depend on a whole naval force in the Persian Gulf. We don't want China in the Gulf of Mexico. So we might just say, reasonably speaking, our country is not less secure by just backing off a couple miles. And I think it opens up the door for discussion. And I think that's what the world needs right now, rather than saying, you do it our way. If you do it our way, we'll give you a lot of money. If you don't do it our way, we're going to send a drone missile over there and start picking at you. So I think it's a completely different foreign policy. It's a very pro-American, strong national defense policy, but it also is living within reason that it's a policy we can afford. Right now, we can't afford this, and we have to get our budget under control.
A new poll today says 56%. WMUR's poll says more than half the voters here in New Hampshire are undecided, probably a lot of them in that room. What's your pitch to them with just hours to go before the voters hit the polls?
Same thing I've been pitching for 30 years. More freedom, less government, lower taxes, strong national defense, looking into the Federal Reserve, and a concentration and emphasis on personal liberty, because this is one state that understands what personal liberty is all about.
And depending on how you do here, you've said you'll go straight to South Carolina. What's the path forward? You've said maybe you're not going to go to Florida. Like, what's the path?
I will stop in South Carolina on Wednesday as we leave here, and we don't have the full campaign in Florida, but we won't be absent. But we'll see how we do tomorrow as well as in South Carolina, and then look at the budget.
Last question. You've been hesitant to answer the third party question, right? So let me try a creative way. What's your opinion of what Ross Perot did and how he ran?
Well, he was very rich. Yes. I'm not very rich. I've contributed some services here, and it distracted me a little bit, you know, from my medical practice. And it also, you know, I gave up my pension fund, my federal pension fund, so I don't have that kind of money. So that's a different story completely. And it is a system that is very biased against third-party movements. And right now, I'm in this. I mean, I'm a contender.
We've tried to follow you around. Yeah. You're like a rock star here.
So that thought doesn't even cross my mind. So I'm not thinking in those terms.
Congressman, we appreciate the time, and we look forward to following you on the campaign trail.
Thank you very much.